David Selig is with us. He is conservative commentator, pro-business advocate, TrueTaxHelp.com, his website over at Selig Associates. And David, you wanted to talk about taxpayer anxiety disorder?
I do, Tom.
Now, I have this column here from the Wall Street Journal. U.S. companies are making record profits. More of the money is staying offshore and lightly taxed. A Wall Street Journal analysis of 60 big U.S. companies found that together they parked a total of $166 billion offshore, shielding 40% of their annual profits from U.S. taxes. And in addition to doing that, they're buying back shares. Though it left the money off limits for paying dividends, buying back shares or making investments. In other words, the rich are getting richer. General Electric, $147 billion, Pfizer, $59 billion, Microsoft, $73 billion, Merck, $47 billion, J&J, $67 billion. The top 1% own more than half of all the stock in the United States. You know, 1% is doing just fine, thank you very much, but not so much the average working person.
You make an excellent point, Tom. Here you've got these corporate fat cats getting away with something short of robbery, but the average person, or better yet, the higher achiever, they are really feeling the full force and effect of the government, who is wringing every last dime out of them. And what has happened, the issue that I'm on your show talking about today, is taxpayer anxiety disorder. Now, I know that at first blush, a lot of your listeners are going to say, this sounds like some sort of gambit.
I'd say a lot of my listeners would be very happy to become taxpayers. There is a frightening number of people, David, in the United States right now who are unemployed or underemployed, who are earning, you know, considerably less than the roughly, you know, $20,000-$25,000 a year that is the bottom, the top end of the poverty
level.
You're
on point, Tom. You know, to quote one of your role models, Ronald Reagan, a rising tide lifts all boats. If we could just release some of these, you know, onerous regulations, it would probably be a lot easier.
Yeah, although when Reagan said that, he was quoting Kennedy.
Okay, well done. You know, one of the issues that we have that is affecting regular people, working people, small business owners, medical doctors and private practice and such, a lot of these people owe the government a great deal of money, and they're really suffering over this. They would like to come clean. The problem is, when they do, they are hit with these debilitating, onerous penalties, a lot of interest. It feels as if they just cannot get out of it. Now, a lot of people say these same taxpayers are shirking their responsibilities. They're really not. It actually takes more effort and stress not to address this issue than it does to. What we're trying to do is work with the government and the psychiatric care community to recognize this issue and have the penalties abated. Because, Tom, that would go a long way in closing the tax gap.
So let me get this right, David. You're saying that if somebody earns their income in a way that isn't a regular wage, so it's not an ordinary deduction. I mean, for most taxpayers, this is an irrelevant issue because their taxes
some
are deducted.
Because of the economy, the administration and such, they were forced to either sell stocks or perhaps break open that 401k, and now they got hit with those penalties, the early distribution penalties of 10%. Now, these are working salaried employees, and on top of that, they have the tax burden. And, Tom, they can't sleep at night. They are so racked with worry. Some of these people will have a generalized anxiety disorder.
You know what we need, David? We need a jubilee.
A jubilee. Do tell.
Well, it's, you know, in the Bible, this is for thousands of years. I mean, this is how Jewish society functioned. Was every 7 years every seventh year you let the fields lay fallow so they could recover from the effects of agriculture, and on every seven times seventh year, the 49th year, you would have the next year, the 50th year would be what's called the Jubilee year every 50 years, and all wealth was equalized. All the rich people gave all their money into the pot, and all the poor people gave all their money into the pot,
Tom,
and it all got split up equally among everybody.
And
all the slaves were freed. I beg your pardon?
You know, are you saying you want to give up your homes and such to the people who don't have, and then at the end of the day, what? We're all even?
Well, I'm not like, you know, Stephen J. Helmsley sitting on lots and lots of homes.
Right. Well, I think you got two or three, right?
No, Louise and I are living on a boat here in D.C., and we've got a house in Portland that is for sale. We've been trying to sell it for 4 years. If anybody wants to buy a floating home in Portland, let me know. But no, we are not among the landed gentry, David.
Right.
But my point is that I think that even regardless of politics and regardless of economics and regardless of where you and I may stand in that whole economic pecking order, that what I'm suggesting is that we have $1 trillion in student loan debt. That's absurd, obscene, and frankly didn't even exist 30 years ago. The idea of student loan debt didn't happen.
So much interest on it.
Right. So we the people should simply step in and say, okay, that's $1 trillion. We're going to just write that off.
Okay.
So now you've got a generation that when they go to work, they can actually spend all of the money they earn. That's going to create demand in the economy, and that's going to stimulate the economy. Because right now they're using a lot of that money from people coming out of college. They get a job, and they use a lot of that money to start paying down their debts. That doesn't stimulate the economy. It makes more money for Jamie Dimon, but not for everybody else.
I don't disagree with you, okay. Tom. I think that's outstanding.
Okay, so we do a debt jubilee for
the penalty portion on the taxes as
right.
well.
We do a debt and tax jubilee exactly on all student loan debt, number one. Number two, on housing debt. Let's say that all housing debt in excess of being underwater, in other words, if your house is worth $200,000 and you owe more than $200,000, and let's actually make it like 15% less than underwater, because really nobody should buy a house without putting down at least 15%, or maybe 10%.
I don't know. I think you were right at 15 or 20, but okay.
Yeah, well, personally, I would like that. But let's just say 10% for even numbers. So if you have a house worth $200,000 and you got a $200,000 loan on it, we'll take $40,000 of that and write it off. And again, we're just gonna write this off. Now if that mortgage was involved at any point with any robo signing, and we know that hundreds of thousands of them were, if there was ever a robo signer involved in the process, the bank eats it.
Yeah, but Tom, we gotta do something about the people who were real volunteers and not victims in this. Remember, not everybody had clean hands.
If there was no robo signer and somebody defrauded the bank.
Wait a minute now. You had a lot of people who came to the table with no intention of honoring their contract.
I don't think so.
Okay.
I really don't think so.
We'll agree to disagree on that issue.
Okay. All right. David Selig, conservative commentator, pro-business advocate. His website, TrueTaxHelp.com. David, thanks for dropping by today.
Hey, thanks a lot. I'm looking forward to being on your next show.
Thank you. Should we have a debt jubilee? Are David and I right? We should just write this stuff off.